Providence has created the Maharajas to offer mankind a spectacle. Thus wrote Rudyard Kipling. Indeed, the Maharajas did provide a spectacle with their fabulous wealth and splendor, pomp and reckless extravagances. But that life of riches and luxury was to end with the passing of the India Independence Act on the 17th of July, 1947. The paramountcy of the British Crown over the princely states would lapse on India becoming independent. The princes were given the option to join one of the two dominions, India or Pakistan. Princely India was a world apart. While some of the rulers had a proud and glorious past, most of them came into existence through accidents of history. During the first half of the 19th century, through subterfuge, deceit, and the doctrine of lapse, the British had taken over a number of states. At the end of India's first war of independence in 1857, the British had occupied 3/5 of the country. The rest of India was under the rule of some 562 feudal chiefs and princes, many of whom had supported the British in suppressing the uprising. In 1858, the administration of India was transferred from the East India Company to the British Crown. On the 1st of November 1858, Queen Victoria's proclamation was read out at Allahabad. It declared that the British had no desire for the extension of their possessions in India and promised to respect the rights, dignity and honor of the Indian princes. Yet, paramountcy, that is indirect rule of the crown, was enforced over the princely states. The princely states were of various shapes and sizes. They varied in size from the large states like Hyderabad and Kashmir to the smallest one, which was less than 1 square kilometer in area, with an annual revenue of only 450 rupees. In every state, the British had posted their representatives, literally to ensure that the rulers remained loyal to the crown. The residents wielded enormous powers. Most of the princes were mere pawns. When George V held a darbar in Delhi, the grateful princes paid their obeisance to their benefactor. While the princes indulged in a life of luxury, they ignored the welfare of their poverty-stricken masses. In 1920, the Indian National Congress called upon the princes to grant full responsible government to their people. The appeal was ignored. Instead, on the recommendation of the Montfort Committee, the Chamber of Princes was created in 1921, perhaps to safeguard the rights and privileges of the rulers. Simmering discontent of the oppressed humanity was being voiced by various political organizations like the Praja Mitra Mandali, All Mahajan Association, Kerala Aikya Munnani, and many others. They sought equal opportunities for all and justice for everyone. In 1927, leading political workers Balwant Rai Mehta, Manilal Kothari and G.R. Abhyankar convened the first All India State People's Conference. The aim was to initiate necessary reforms in administration by the force of collective opinion of the people of the states. At the second roundtable conference in London, Gandhiji advised the princes not to toe the British line, but to become trustees of their people. The civil disobedience movement was launched in states like Mansa, Mysore and Rajkot and several other places. At Rajkot, Gandhiji and Sardar Patel joined UN Debar to intensify the movement. Mysore granted recognition to the Congress Party and permitted flying of the Congress flag along with the state's flag on important occasions. Jaipur banned the activities of the Praja Mandal and refused the entry of Jamnalal Bajaj. A massive demonstration compelled the rulers to lift the ban on Jamnalal Bajaj and the Praja Mandal. Praja Mandals were established in Patiala, Nabha, Jind and Faridkot. At Faridkot, Gyani Zail Singh led the movement. Jai Narayan Vyas organized a movement against the autocratic rule of the Jodhpur Maharaja. Novakrishna Chaudhary, Malati Chaudhary, Sarangadev Das and others organized the State People's Conference in Orissa. R.R. Divakar in Mysore, Yashwant Singh Parmar in the Punjab Hill States. Achyut Patwardhan led a movement against the rulers of Satara. The 1935 Act envisaged that the provinces and the princely states of India would be brought together into a federation. There was lack of response from the princes. Moreover, the Viceroy took no initiative to invite the princes to join the federation. Sheikh Abdullah organized a mass movement against the ruler of Jammu and Kashmir. In 1939, the Kashmir National Conference was born. The Sheikh was imprisoned 9 times for challenging the Maharaja's misrule. By the end of the Second World War in 1945, India was advancing towards freedom. But the princely states were fighting hard to retain their feudal rights. On January the 17th, 1946, the Chamber of Princes met in Delhi. Lord Wavell advised the small states to group themselves into units capable of running a reasonable administration. But the princes were not interested. The princes refused to see the writing on the wall and did not move with the changing times. The Cabinet Mission Plan for Transfer of Power, announced on the 16th of May 1946, envisaged the framing of the future constitution of India by an elected constituent assembly. The princely states were to be released from paramountcy and were asked to work out their own relations with the successive authorities. They were allotted 93 seats in the constituent assembly. While enlightened rulers of Baroda, Bikaner, Cochin and Patiala joined the assembly in the larger interest of the country, others stayed away. Presiding over the All India States People's Conference in June 1946, Jawaharlal Nehru said, "Those who do not join the Constituent Assembly now would be regarded as hostile states." The India Independence Bill received the royal assent on the 18th of July 1947. The princes were advised by Lord Mountbatten to keep in view the geographical compulsions and join India or Pakistan before the Independence Day, 15th of August 1947. The rulers were required to sign a standstill agreement which terminated the British paramountcy and an instrument of accession to the dominion of their choice. On the 5th of July 1947, a Department of States was created under Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel with V.P. Menon as the secretary. Sardar Patel advised the rulers to ensure the fundamental unity of the country and maintain the administrative continuity. He said, "We are all knit together by the bonds of blood in view of our own allegiance to our motherland and for the common good of all of us." Soon after, Sardar Patel and V.P. Menon began to meet the rulers of various princely states: Gwalior, Indore, Bhavnagar, Nawanagar, Jaipur, Bikaner, Mysore, Baroda and many others. In spite of indifferent health, Sardar Patel kept long hours appealing to the patriotic senses of the princes to come to terms and help him build a strong and united India. BP Menon records that Jinnah met the Maharaja of Jodhpur and gave him a blank sheet of paper to fill in his conditions for joining Pakistan. He tried to persuade Jaisalmer to go along, but did not succeed. Baroda, Bikaner, Mysore, Patiala, Gwalior, Cochin and some other states signed the standstill agreement and the instrument of accession. After initial hesitation, Bhopal and Indore too decided in favor of India. B.P. Menon writes, during a meeting, the Maharaja of Jodhpur pulled out a pistol and threatened to shoot. When the threat did not work, he succumbed to the Sardar. The Diwan of Travancore, C.P. Ramaswamy Iyer, announced that he would advise the Maharaja not to sign the instrument of accession and declare his state as independent. It was in fact a declaration of his own doom at the hands of the aggrieved people of the state. Pattam Thanu Pillai and Kelappan led an agitation against the Diwan. The people literally assaulted the Diwan. The Maharaja bowed to the popular demand and acceded to India. Junagadh in the Kathiawad Peninsula was surrounded by states who had joined India, but the Nawab created a sensation by announcing his intention to join Pakistan. Samaldas Gandhi organized a massive satyagraha. A referendum was held and the people decided to join India. Only Hyderabad and Kashmir still nurtured faint hopes of avoiding accession. Both the states signed the standstill agreement, but time and events were soon to shatter their dream. On the 26th of October 1947, hordes of tribals from Pakistani territory invaded Kashmir. Sheikh Abdullah, who had been released from jail, was asked by the Maharaja to head an emergency administration. The Maharaja sent a wire to New Delhi seeking military help. In the absence of an agreement, it could not be given. Sheikh Abdullah organized local militia for the defense of the Kashmir Valley. On the advice of the Sheikh, the Maharaja signed the instrument of accession. Units of the Indian Army were rushed to Srinagar for the defense of the valley. After 3 months of intense fighting, the threat to the valley was repulsed. By the end of 1947, it was fully evident that regular Pakistani army units were fighting in Kashmir.
The people of Kashmir have passed through untold miseries during the last 15 months. They consider themselves part and parcel of this great country. They will never forget India and its gallant Jawan who have been with them through thick and thin.
On the 1st of November 1948, India complained to the United Nations and sought the withdrawal of Pakistani troops from Indian territory. International politics came into play. Even now, 37 years later, Pakistani troops are in illegal occupation of a large part of Indian territory. Soon after independence, the princely states of various parts of the country were amalgamated into larger units. All the states of the Deccan Plateau and Kolhapur were merged with the then Bombay province. Baroda also joined the Bombay province in May 1949. Pratap Singh Gaikwad, the ruler of Baroda, said,
I am integrating my state today into the dominion of India, hoping that this would be in the interest of the country as a whole.
Vindhya Pradesh, a union of 38 states, was born at Rewa in April 1948. Mysore too joined the Indian Union. The Mysore Maharaja, Jaya Chamaraja Wadiyar, was nominated as the Raj Pramukh. At Gwalior, Madhya Bharat was inaugurated by Jawaharlal Nehru on the 28th of May 1948.
इस मध्य भारत में दो ऐसे बड़े राज्य, प्रतिष्ठित राज्य, ऐतिहासिक राज्य ग्वालियर और इंदौर था, जिनमें अलग रहने की भी शक्ति थी, लेकिन फिर भी उन्होंने ये निश्चय किया इस मध्य भारत में आना। और मैं समझता हूँ कि जो उन्होंने निश्चय किया ये वो ठीक निश्चय किया, हर तरह से ठीक किया, और मैं उनको बधाई देता हूँ उसके लिए।
ऑन द 15th ऑफ जुलाई पटियाला, नाभा, Jind, Faridkot, Kapurthala and Malerkotla joined together to form the Patiala and East Punjab States Union, PEPSU. The Maharaja of Patiala was sworn in as the Raj Pramukh. Out of the states of Kathiawad, Saurashtra was created, with Rajkot as its headquarters. Jam Sahib of Nawanagar was appointed as the Raj Pramukh. A federation of Rajputana states became Greater Rajasthan, with Jaipur as its capital. The Maharaja of Jaipur became the Raj Pramukh. The union of Travancore and Cochin was created, with the Maharaja of Travancore as the Raj Pramukh. Smaller states were merged with contiguous areas of different provinces. Cooch Bihar was merged with West Bengal. Tehri Garhwal, Rampur and Banaras with Uttar Pradesh. The Khasi Hill states were merged with Assam. Bilaspur, Kutch, Tripura, Manipur, Bhopal and the Punjab hill states were taken over by the centre and placed under the charge of chief commissioners. The Nizam of Hyderabad continued to resist accession because of the pressure from Qasim Rizvi and his militant Razakars. The law and order situation was deteriorating. Swami Ramanand Tirth, the president of the Hyderabad State Congress, apprised the government of India of the atrocities committed by the Razakars. He demanded immediate action to save life and property. India decided to put an end to Qasim Rizvi's reign of terror. A police action was launched on the 9th of September 1948. The people of the state welcomed Indian Jawans as their saviors. Qasim Rizvi and his cronies escaped to Pakistan. The Nizam acceded to India and accepted the constitution of the Indian Union. Now, free from the fear of Razakars, the Nizam of Hyderabad personally received Sardar Patel, who had come to accept the accession of the state to India. First, General Chowdhury, later Shri K.M. Munshi, administered the state. In 1950, Hyderabad was amalgamated into Andhra Pradesh. On 26th November 1949, Sardar Patel announced in the Constituent Assembly, all the nine states specified in the first schedule of the Constitution, including Hyderabad, had signed their acceptance of the constitution which this house is going to adopt. The fragmented map of India emerged as a single unit, as one nation. The century-old dream became a reality.